Hello friends, welcome to GuruKate. So today we'll be studying about continental drift. So if we talk of continental drift, and the name itself suggests continents and drifting, whether the continents have drifted or not, this in itself is a debate. So if we talk of this debate also, there were two schools of thought in the earlier times. One was permanency of oceans and continents, and other school was that no, the continents have drifted. So that is what we'll try to find out. If we talk of permanency of oceans and continents, there was a person called as Harold Jeffrey. What he said was that the oceans and continents have remained permanent. As we see them on map today, they have remained there since the ages. They have not drifted at all. Now, if we talk of this theory or continental drift theory also, why are we studying this? It is because of the features. Various features, that is mountains, plateaus, plains, depressions, oceans, seas, how exactly these features have come into picture, right? How or what are the reasons that we see so many features, diverse features on the surface of the earth, landforms, how they are formed. So these theories try to answer it then. So when we talk of permanency of oceans and continents, what Harold Jeffrey said was that it is the theory of contraction. According to the contraction theory, these features have been formed. Now how? Simply imagine. If we say this is our earth, again, geography is all about imagination. You have to imagine, right? So if this is a sphere or earth for that matter, if it contracts, what will it lead into or what will it result into? Simply certain wrinkles will be created, right, on this particular surface. Now what he said was that it is these wrinkles, that is either a mountain or a depressions or various features that we think of in this way, they have been created. So this was the theory, the thermal contraction theory put forward by Harold Jeffrey, which tried to prove that permanency of oceans and continents is a fact, right? But next, there were many geographers, many scientists who did not, you know, accept this theory in entirety. What they said was, no, it is the continents that have drifted. And similarly, there was a geographer named Alfred Wegener. He came up with his own theory of continent drifting, right? Continental drift. So herein, it was not entirely his product. What he did was, there were many geographers who have already given various evidences. So he accumulated and compiled those evidences and came forward with his own theory, that is continental drift theory. So first, we will be talking of these evidences now. So the first evidence is anthracite coal. If we talk of anthracite coal, it is the best quality coal that we get on earth. And this anthracite coal is found in temperate region, right? Anthracite coal in temperate region is the first evidence. Now, if we talk of anthracite coal, right, being the best quality, how will it get formed? For best quality coal to be, formed, there are two things which are necessary. One is lush green forests, preferably evergreen forests, and second is time that it will take to convert, right, into fossil fuel. So, if we talk of lush green evergreen forest, what region do you think on earth will have such lush green forests? Obviously, it is the tropical region. Why? Because of sunlight. Because of abundant sunlight in the tropical region, we'll get lush green forests there, which when submerged for various or for a long period of time, right, long duration, will get converted into coal. We know this as a fact. Now, similarly, if we talk of this particular fact or if we think about it, it is this region which would have the best quality coal, but it is found that it is this particular region which has best quality coal. What is the reason? So this was put forward as an evidence that these regions, right, these regions which were tropical at that time must have got lush green forests. Then they would have submerged and then these land masses would have drifted. So this says that yes, the continents might have drifted. So this was one evidence. Now if we talk of the second evidence, as you can look into the picture as well, it is about the jigsaw fit, right? I'm sure you must be knowing about the jigsaw fit since childhood, you must have been playing the game. So here in jigsaw fit, if you look at the African continent and the continent of South America, do you feel there is some similarity that we can think of, right? See, like this. This is the continent of South America. And this is somewhat Africa. If you look, these two regions, right? That is the Gulf of Guinea and the protruding part of the Brazil, Brazilian Highland. Here we have Cape São Roque. So these two places or these two regions, if you see very closely, they can fit exactly into each other, as we have already seen in the picture, right? So this was the jigsaw fit that was put forward as an evidence stating that they must have been fused at some or the other part of time, and today they are present in the separate regions. So continental drift. Next evidence that was put forward was about rocks. Here the rocks were of same ages is what they say. If you talk of Katanga Plateau, right, which is in African continent, and Patagonia region, which is in South American continent, this part and this part, right? So if you look at the rocks, they are more or less of same age. Their structure, not exactly structure, but characteristics, or what do we say, thickness or type, everything more or less is of same age and same time. How is this possible today when you have such big Atlantic Ocean between them? Apart from that, if you talk of other mountains also, Appalachian Mountain, right? Appalachian Mountain, which is present in the North American region. Appalachian Mountain, then the Newfoundland Island, Notre Dame, right? Apart after that, you have the Grampian Mountains in UK, you have Pennines, and then the Jolan Mountains, which is present in the Scandinavian region. If you look into the map in front of you, you can see these mountains. So all these mountains also have same type or same aged rocks. How is that possible? One, that they might have, these regions might have been fused at a particular time. So this was put forward as another evidence for continental drift. Apart from that, other evidence that we have is of fossils. Again, as you can see into the picture, if we talk of fossils, Cynognathus. Cynognathus is found in South America and in Africa. If you talk of Mesosaurus, Mesosaurus is found in South America, Africa, and South Asia. Next, Glossopteris. Glossopteris is found in South America, Africa, South Asia, and Antarctica. And if you talk of lemur, right? Lemur is an ape-like animal. So India, Madagascar, and South Africa. So these regions had lemur. Again, flora and fauna, if we think of them today, is it possible for them to cross vast oceans and be present at this other place at the same time? It is very difficult. So this was put forward as an evidence for continental drift. If we talk of lemur also, you must have heard of Lemuria. Lemuria was a land which had lemurs present there. So it was India, Madagascar, and South Africa at that time. These three big areas, continents or regions which were fused together, having this particular fauna or animal, that is lemur. Next, if we talk of the evidence, it was stilite. It is glacial till. Now, what is glacial till? It is the sediments which is a result of the movement of a glacier. When a glacier moves, it creates erosion, and because of that erosion, various sediments are formed. Now, these sediments, after few years, is going to get converted into a sedimentary rock. And if you talk of the sedimentary rock, same type, same age has been found again in various regions like Africa, Falkland Island, Madagascar, Antarctica, Australia, and India. How is it possible? Just imagine, same time, same place, same kind of sediments, a glacier is coming and it is going to, bring in same sediments and same type of rock is forming. How is this possible? Unless and until all these lands must have been fused at some point in the geological time scale, in the past, it is not possible, right? Also, if you can think more over it, if we talk of glacier, if we talk of ice age also, India being a very tropical country, just imagine in the southern parts of India, which is very close to equator, that is covered with glacial till. Again, this was a big anomaly that the geographers at that time thought of. So here in the glacial till, which is found similar kind, same age, the rocks is present in all these regions, was put forward as an evidence. Next evidence was placer deposit. Now what are exactly placer deposits? Placer deposits are small particles of a particular mineral. For this example or for here, we are going to talk of gold, placer deposits of gold. Now if you talk of gold deposits, it was found near Ghana coast. This particular region, right? Now, as we know, Ghana is a country in Africa, right? African continent, this area. Coffee beans, I'm sure you must be knowing. So here, Ghana coast had lots of gold particles. Now, how are these placer deposits created in the first place? It is a geomorphic agent. For example, let us talk of a river. A river simply moves over a rock which contains gold or any mineral particle in it. The river will keep on eroding it, and those flakes or those particles will move into the river, and when that river meets the ocean, it gets deposited into the ocean. So this is what, or this is how the placer deposits of gold would have been found in this coast, right? That is the Gulf of Guinea or in front of Ghana. But the problem is the rocks which are present here does not have gold at all. Then how come gold placer deposits came in this particular region? Again, after research, it was found out this region, this particular region of Brazil has lots of gold present in the rocks. So it is said that it was the rivers that must have eroded this rock, and when these two regions were fused, or they must have just started to drift apart from each other, that time the rivers must have deposited the gold in this particular coast. So this is again about placer deposits, and these are the evidences, right, which say that yes, the continents must have been fused at some or the other point in the geological time scale. But today, since they are, you know, not fused, they are separate, what is the reason? The continents might have drifted, right? So these were the evidences put forward by Alfred Wegener, and based on these evidences, what he said was that during the mid Mesozoic times, right, at that time the drifting started. Before that, there was a supercontinent, all the land masses fused together. He named it as Pangaea. So supercontinent, wherein all the land masses, all the continents that we have today were fused, he called it as Pangaea. And a super ocean, right, that was called as Panthalassa. So it was Pangaea and Panthalassa. During the mid Mesozoic times, they started drifting. Simply, this supercontinent got divided into two parts, right? Laurasia and Gondwana land. So this continent got drifted or separated into two regions, that is Laurasia, Laurentia, and Gondwana land. And it was separated by Tethys Sea, because water took over this particular region. So this was called by him Tethys Sea. So this is what Alfred Wegener said at that time while putting forward his theory, that there was a supercontinent named Pangaea and a super ocean called as Panthalassa. During mid Mesozoic times, the land started to drift apart, and when it got drifted, first it broke into two pieces, forming northern portion, that is Laurasia or Laurentia, and the southern portion called as Gondwana land, and it was separated by a Tethys Sea, right? Now, how exactly these two parts moved, or what was the reason for the continents to drift? This was one of the most important supporting point that this theory needed, because the geographers asked, if you are saying that the continents are drifting, what is the force that is responsible for its drifting? So next, this is what we are going to see. So if we talk of the two forces, or if we talk of Alfred Wegener's theory, he said that there were two kinds of motions. One was westward, another was poleward, right? Westward and poleward. So if we talk of the westward motion, right, westward movement of these continents, what was the force that was responsible for it? According to him, it was the tidal force, right? And when we talk of this tidal force, why are tides created on Earth? We know it is because of the gravitational pull of moon and sun, right? So moon and sun and rotation of the Earth. If we talk of rotation of the Earth, Earth rotates from west to east, we all know this, and it is the moon and sun which keep on, you know, exerting a gravitational or attractive force. Because of this, this way will be the pulling force, and the continents started moving when we talk of sun or a moon which are exerting a gravitational pull. And see, as we know, if the Earth is rotating from west to east, what is the motion of the waves? It is from east to west. So it is that particular force, tidal force, which was responsible for the movement of land westward, according to Alfred Wegener. Second was the pole fleeing force. Now, what exactly is pole fleeing force? Earth we know is a geoid and it keeps on rotating. So here there are two, three forces which are acting together. One, the centrifugal force. We know that Earth is bulged across the equator. This is the geoid shape, right? flattened at the poles and bulged towards equator. So the centrifugal force that is exerted over the equatorial region is one of the reason which is causing the land to move towards the poles. Second, as we know, since the earth is, you know, flat at the poles, the gravitational pull of the poles is more compared to the central region. So this is second reason why again they are being pulled. So pole fleeing force, it is the gravitational pull as well as the centrifugal force. And another factor what he said is acting here is the buoyancy force. When we talk of buoyancy force or the buoyant force of water, we know whatever we throw on water, it keeps on floating unless it is very heavy, it will go down. So here it is the force exerted by water. This was the force that he said which was used for movement of a particular landmass or the continents. So buoyancy force, gravitational force and the centrifugal force caused the continents to drift apart as a pole fleeing force. So based on these forces, these continent or these landmasses are going to move. Now again here, just imagine an entire landmass is moving on a water, like a continent is moving on a water. Is it possible? So here Alfred Wegener took help of Edward Suess's theory. Right? Edward Suess. What he said was that it is Sial and Sima. Sial means the continental crustal portion and Sima is the oceanic crustal portion. So it is Sial which moves over Sima. Is it clear? See, it is very simple. Sial, the continental crustal portion, moving over the oceanic crustal portion, which results into movement of the continents or drifting of the continents. Now, this itself became one of the biggest point of criticism. So, next that we are going to talk about this theory is criticisms of this theory. Sial over Sima. Today, because we know that it is plate tectonics which is responsible for movement, entire crustal portion including the oceanic crust moves. So we know it. But at that time, this became one of the biggest criticism that how can Sial move over Sima. Apart from that, the second criticism that we can talk about this theory as it was said at that time was the forces. The forces that Alfred Wegener said were very weak forces. Just imagine the tidal force. It is the moon and sun which is exerting a force today also. So are the continents drifting towards the west? And it is not such a huge force, or the magnitude of that force is not so big that it can pull a continent, right? A continental landmass. It is just the waves or tides for that matter. I'm sorry. It is the tides which are created, not the continents. So the magnitude of the tidal forces or the pole fleeing forces that Alfred Wegener put forward was criticized on a very big scale. And apart from that, third criticism that you can say or write in the exam is about the time. They asked him that why was it only mid Mesozoic times that the continent started to drift? What happened before, right? Before, did the continents ever drifted, or it was just the mid Mesozoic period during which they started drifting? So these were the general criticisms that were put forward in front of continental drift theory. At that time, it was the continental drift theory was a very futuristic theory. But later on, and these evidences as well as the forces that were put forward by Alfred Wegener couldn't really, give solid proof or solid evidence that yes, the continent drifted. But later on, we got various theories, right? Like the seafloor spreading theory and the comprehensive plate tectonic theory, which proved that yes, the continents have drifted. We are going to talk of those theories as well. When we talk of various features like mountains, earthquake, volcanoes, how did they take place? How did Alfred Wegener try to answer them was something like this. When he said, or when he used the theory of Sial moving over Sima from Edward Suess, by with the help of diagrams, I'll try to explain it to you. Suppose this is Sima, that is oceanic crust, right? Sima, that is oceanic crust. And we have a block of Sial. Sial, that is continental crust. So according to him, it is Sial that moves over Sima, right? Simply Sial moving over Sima. What he said was, when this continental block is moving over Sima, there is going to be friction between those two blocks, and that friction leads to earthquakes that we have today. This was one that he said. Second, if we talk of volcanoes, while moving, in case there is a fracture, right, or a crack somewhere in this particular crustal oceanic crust, in that case the magma will spew out. The magma will spew out as volcanoes. And if you took a fold mountains, what he said was, when this CL moves over sima, it is going to scratch this particular surface. And because of scratching of this surface, slowly and steadily, it is the rock fragments and, you know, various rock particles which will keep on accumulating. And at one point of time, the accumulation is so high that it gives rise to formation of a mountain. For example, just look at what I draw. In this way, because of the cracks, it has kept on accumulating. And after some time, it has risen so much that it takes shape of a fold mountain. So this is how mountains are created, because of the CL moving over sima. So this is what Alfred Wegener talked about, the features and how they are formed. Now, as we know, the CL and sima theory itself has been rejected by the geographers. And this is a very basic, explanation regarding how these features are formed. But the true answer, when we talk of these features, we'll understand is in plate tectonic theory, right? So now we have finished with the conceptual part of continental drift theory. Now let's look at the questions that has been asked in UPSC. So if you talk of a question in mains 2013, there was a direct question on continental drift. Simply the question said, what do you understand by the theory of continental drift? Discuss the prominent evidences in its support. Now, if you have to tackle this question, what exactly are you going to write? Suppose if this question is for 10 marker, right? 10 or 12 marker. In that case, first understand and underline the keywords. One, continental drift theory. Simple question, what is theory of continental drift? And second part is evidences, right? Very, very important is evidences. Now, if we talk of this question, there has to be three parts. One is introduction, another is main body, next is your conclusion. So if you talk of introduction, in brief, you can directly address the first part of the question, what do you understand by the theory of continental drift? I'm not going to give you or tell you the entire answer right now. There will be a model answer for this, but apart from that, how you have to tackle is what I will help you with. So in this question, definition or, you know, about continental drift, a brief understanding of continental drift is what you can write, given by whom, theory, when, if you know, right, the year, etc., you can write. Apart from that, simply draw a small diagram regarding continental drift, whatever you know of, right? You can show the continents drifting, or the diagram that we saw, Pangaea, Panthalassa, Laurentia, Gondwana land, Tethys Sea, a simple diagram, anything related to continental drift is what you can draw. Major part of this question is prominent evidences. Now, when you talk of this part also, there are two parts into it. If we talk of Alfred Wegener's continental drift theory, then we have to write the evidences which are given by Alfred Wegener only. But in this case, since the question talks of theory of continental drift, one, you can write evidences given by Alfred Wegener or in support of Alfred Wegener's theory, which we have already seen, right? If you remember, it is jigsaw fit, right? In the chapter, in the lecture, we already seen. So it is jigsaw fit, right? Glacial tillite, placer deposit, anthracite coal, etc. Apart from that, you also have to write about theories or, you know, some very important proofs or evidences which were given post theory. For example, the convectional current theory, or seafloor spreading, or the plate tectonics theory in general. So these are again certain solid evidences which again talk of continental drift. So herein, if you write this answer, simply an introduction, a diagram. In the main body, when you're talking of evidences, one, you can write evidences according to Alfred Wegener or as per his theory. Apart from that, other evidences supporting the theory, as I've already told you, seafloor spreading, right? Convectional current theory by Arthur Holmes. We'll see. We are going to discuss those theory also in next lectures. So that is what you're going to write, and plate tectonics theory. And finally, come to a conclusion. In conclusion, again, you can write whatever you feel. You can write about a prominent evidence, right? If you talk of continental drift or anything with respect to continental drift, that's it. So this will be your mains answer, a simple structure that you can write. Now, if we talk of a question prelims, right? In 2014 prelims, there appeared a question on continental drift which read, which of the following phenomena might have influenced the evolution of organisms? One, continental drift. Two, glacial cycles. Now please pause the video and try to think over this before understanding or, you know, listening the answer. So if we talk of answer to this question, simply here the keyword is evolution of organism and influence. Is there influence of these two on evolution of organisms? That is what we have to think. Now, if we talk of evolution of organisms, when do you think an organism evolves? If there are certain changed conditions, as simple as that, right? Be it genetic, be it environmental, or whatever it is. Now, here, with respect to continental drift and glacial cycles, are they responsible for any change with respect to an organism? That is what we need to understand. Now, if we talk of continental drift for that matter, like we had seen in example of anthracite coal, during formation of anthracite coal, what happened exactly? It was the tropical region which had lush evergreen forest which got submerged, and we say that the continent might have moved, the landmass might have moved to the temperate region, and there we have coal formation. So forget about the coal formation here, just understand or try to imagine the conditions when that particular landmass was in tropical reach or region, and when it moved to temperate conditions or temperate region. Was there a change in conditions? Obviously, right? Of course there was change with respect to climatic events, with respect to weather, temperature, what all you can think of, all the elements, they are going to change with respect to the rock conditions, right? Various geomorphic phenomena that will happen in that place. If everything changes, we know that organisms try to evolve to adapt to that particular area. And similarly, when we say the continents are going to drift, organisms will evolve because they have to adapt to the new area to survive, survival of the fittest. This also talks of that concept. Next is glacial cycle. If we talk of glacial cycles, it is again a period of glacier, no glacier. Ice ages, right? Glacier will be there, no glacier. So cold, warm, these are the differing conditions which we can think of or imagine with respect to glacial cycles. So again, since the conditions are changing here, it is highly possible that it will influence evolution of organism. So if we talk of this particular question, what is going to be the answer? Very simple. Both 1 and 2, right? So this will be the answer. So this was all about continental drift theory. I hope you have understood the concept well, and this will help you answer any question that come in prelims or mains. Now, apart from this, if you have any doubts, or if you want to know something else, or if there is a topic which you feel is a bit hard and you want it to be simplified, you can mention it in the comment box and I'll make a video for that. And apart from that, the next topics after this that we are going to take is convection current theory and seafloor spreading, moving on to plate tectonics. So I hope you like the lecture. If you like it, please press the like, subscribe and share button. Thank you very much.